I must say, by the Department of Biotechnology. And it started in a small way, but today I am so happy. Anywhere, any university, even in the colleges when I go, they tell me, oh, we have a small sub-DIC of DBT. It's so nice to see. There is no regional imbalance. DBT was very clear that we don't want to have regional imbalance. We don't want to focus everything in Bangalore, Bombay, Delhi, Madras, like that. We must go throughout the country, from northeast down to the south. West, east, everywhere we should go. So that sub-DICs were set up. And yesterday I saw Dr. Arora here from the DBT. He was the advisor, and Dr. Madan Mohan. What an effort they made to spread the bioinformatics culture in the country. Then the human resource development. We have more than 72 departments, and I must say that the officer concerned who has been doing outstanding work for human resource development, going reaching each university, colleges, wherever there is a seed of biology, they have gone and developed it. And that's Dr. Suman Goel. And because it's the 30 years, I thought I must mention the names of some of the officers who have been with DBT from the time it was set up as a National Biotechnology Board. And Suman certainly did outstanding work in the human resource development area, 72 departments of biotechnology. Then we didn't want to just say, be called that we'll be just doing only the work of high quality research, frontline research, cutting edge research in modern biology. So we started some programs for societal benefit. And I was so happy to see yesterday, Vijay, that those awards were given for societal work. And this program was started in 96 for societal benefit, rural women, SCST, in different regions, and even attending to the natural calamities. Whenever there was an earthquake or there was some problem, the Department of Biotechnology was almost the leader in the science departments to go ahead and do something for the rehabilitation of the victims, to provide some employment opportunities. We have been to Kutch, we have been to Uttarakhand, all these regions we visited just to provide the help to the victims of those natural calamities. We were starting with multi-institutional mission mode programs. Several awards for the benefit of young biologists were instituted. And one of the National Bioscience Award for young scientists, you know, something was very interesting, at least when I was there, I started in DBT, that when Shanti Sarup Bhatnagar Awards were presented, 2-3 years continuously I noticed that from the DBT institutions, the scientists were there, whether it was NII or ICGB or NCCS, and the scientists from DBT institutions went and received the Shanti Sarup Bhatnagar Award. So I thought, why not we also start something? And the National Bioscience Award for the young scientists was basically instituted, but we had some financial crunch, so we made it only a lakh of rupees. But still, that award has paved the way for many young researchers to join the biotechnology as in the mainstream. We had several international collaborations, US, UK, Switzerland, France, Germany, with the Indo-US Vaccine Action Program. I'm sure all of you know it was such a record program, and I'm very happy Dr. T.S. Rao is sitting here, how much hard work Dr. Rao did, and Mr. Sinha also, for to see that in the Indo-US Vaccine Action Program, while the vaccines were developed, at least more than 200 to 300 young scientists of this country were trained in United States. That was the flagship of that program. That while the vaccines take a very long time, but we decided that we must get the training for these younger people. Then, of course, the several advanced facilities have been created and infrastructure which has been built in the country. Well, what happened? Okay, we have 15 autonomous institutions today, and as Dr. Vijay Raghavan said, NII was although started in the DST, the seeds I must say soon. But basically NII flourished when it came with the DBT. And similarly, we went on to create many important institutions, the Brain Research Center, the National Plant Genome Research Institute, and today, Translational Research, and so many now, all of you know all the new institutions of DBT. An important, important component of the DBT activities was the two advisory committees. One was the SAC-DBT, which was really headed by very, very important and eminent scientists of the country, who really were, from the day one, the pillars of the growth of biotechnology, Professor M.S. Swaminathan, Professor P.N. Tandon, Professor Padmanabhan, and many others who are sitting here, Dr. Ashish Datta. I know even when he was in the university, how closely he was working with DBT, Dr. Kamboj, all the time helping us with the regulatory structures, transfer of technology, etc. So many, many senior scientists were involved in the SAC-DBT program. And a unique feature of the DBT was SAC Overseas. It was for the first time in the country SAC Overseas was constituted, where we had eminent scientists from abroad who had interest in the Department of Biotechnology and who became a member, and we used to meet once in a year. And this is very unusual. The whole thing was paid by the Government of India, just because we wanted the expertise from the abroad to be useful for the Indian scientists. And that was the reason we had people like Dr. Anand Chakravarti, Professor Inder Verma, and so many, Dr. G.S. Khosh, and many, many other people who were all the members of the SAC-DBT. In fact, three scientists from SAC Overseas, Vijay, who played a very important role in the Department of Biotechnology were Dr. Anand Chakravarti, Professor Inder Verma, and Dr. G.S. Khosh. Dr. G.S. Khosh gave us the guidance in the International Rice Genome Program. He was monitoring it, he was guiding the group, both at Professor Aklesh Tyagi's center in the South Campus and in ICR. Similarly, Professor Inder Verma, he was the one who told and guided us to start the genetic counseling units. And today we have more than 16 RAU in genetic counseling units in the country. The initial PGI Chandigarh was,
21.
Oh, very good, 21. So unit was established at PGI Chandigarh. This was all the help of Dr. Inder Verma. And particularly when we looked at the cases of thalassemia, very much in Punjab area, and many other diseases which were really now, we were not still able to diagnose that they were the genetic disorders. These counseling units were very, very helpful. And today I see a whole institute in Kolkata with Partha. So, you know, the small efforts of starting the initiative of genetic counseling units, seed was sown by Professor Inder Verma, today is seen a new institute in the country. Similarly, the plant genome research, what Dr. Khosh was helping us, ultimately the CPMB and the South Campus, they all became a National Plant Genome Research Institute, Dr. BCIL, interface between research and industry. We had nobody. If you do laboratory research, where do you go? NRDC was the only organization, and they were too busy with CSIR. So we needed something for biotechnology. So we had the BCIL established. And so the SAC Overseas was really a very, very useful structure for the DBT, and we utilized it fully. Then we had subject-wise task forces, more than 16 to 20 task forces. Each one of you sitting here, many of you, in fact, were involved with all these task forces. We had several programs, monitoring units, etc. And at the instance of the Government of India, we prepared a vision document in 2001, and which was released by the Honorable Prime Minister. And that vision document really gave something like a roadmap as to how we should proceed during that period when we were just beginning to grow. So the vision document almost became a guiding light for us. And this was the statement which we made it in the vision document. And I still remember Professor Padmanabhan and Professor Tandon and myself, we sat together. And of course, Dr. Renu Sarup, who was all the time helping me with this vision document. we prepared this Attaining New Heights in Biotechnology Research, Shaping Biotechnology into a Premier Precision Tool of the Future for Creation of Wealth and Ensuring Social Justice, especially for the welfare of the poor. That was our vision. We wanted to do that. Believe me, this was a very sincere statement we had made, and we really wanted to proceed in that manner. Then this document was released in January, and by the then Prime Minister, as I mentioned. We also had the RDNA guidelines for the first time in the country. In fact, not only for the first time in the country, Vijay, we were told that this was the first guideline available in the Asian region, which we prepared with the Dr. Vardarajan and many, many senior people who were the leaders who sat together, and the RDA guidelines were prepared. We had the guidelines for transgenics. Professor R.P. Sharma, Professor V.L. Chopra, they prepared it. Of course, the BCIL came, and the breakthrough was the BT cotton, the first genetically modified crop, released on 26 March 2002. This was a very great effort. Lot of difficulties we faced, including from NGOs, but we were firm. We said, nothing doing. What we are doing is correct, and we will do it. So the BT cotton was released. And you have heard from Dr. Bhatia yesterday, and also from many others, how BT cotton has benefited the poorest of the poor farmer in different states. We know that, all that acreage and everything, what, how much, and I'll show you just now. Oh, sorry, I should have mentioned. Then the biotech industry mushroomed, and of course, the golden lining, I would say, not the silver lining, golden lining was the setting up of BIRAC, which came, and thanks to Dr. Bhan and his vision, the BIRAC was set up, the SIBRI was set up, and suddenly the biotech industry mushroomed in the country. With the efforts of the Department of Biotechnology, everybody today knows what is BIRAC. Everybody, you talk to the industry people, you talk to the scientists, let's go to BIRAC if we have something to develop and commercialize. So BIRAC, setting up of the BIRAC was a new era, I would say, of biotechnology research and development. Now today we are celebrating 30 years of DBT, but there was a time when 50 years of the DNA discovery were celebrated all over the world. And T.S. Rao knows all about it. He was the one who helped me. And we invited Dr. Watson here, but last minute, just a week before, he fell ill and his doctor advised him not to travel. So he sent this very beautiful message to DBT. You can read it, that I want the success of biotechnology in your country. And he also very clearly mentioned that whatever work is to, this knowledge is going to give should improve the quality of life of human being. And so in a big way, just like you have this global summit, we had a big celebration. We celebrated with a conference, international conference. We had several very top experts of the country. And we thought that this discovery must be celebrated because it is this discovery which has brought into being the whole field of biotechnology. And we are progressing so well. And two statements, very important. One was because Dr. Watson later on came to Indian Science Congress at my invitation when I was the president of the Science Congress. And he said, while he was addressing a public meeting, we used to think that our fate was in our stars. Now we know in large part that our fate is in our genes. It was such a jam-packed conference with almost 5,000 to 6,000 students where he said this. Later on, we were also told that Crick, when the discovery was there, he had predicted in 5 years the impact on medicine will be big, in 10 or 15 years, it will be overwhelming. And why I have put this here is that DBT is doing so well in the pharma sector. We are working on so many vaccines. We have established a translational research institute. And now it is time that we must see that this impact of the medical biotechnology becomes really overwhelming. New diagnostics, new vaccines, new therapeutics have to come out for the use of the people, affordable ones for for our poor people particularly. There are so many things, and I don't want to go into the details of the diagnostics, but we have started the work, and there's no need why we cannot go ahead and do it. We have all the expertise in the country. Agriculture. Again, Dr. Bhatia gave a very nice lecture yesterday about food security. I know nobody can speak better than him on the food security, and particularly the importance of the genetically modified crops, what he spoke yesterday. And we were very clear that a designer crop is the dream of the scientists. In fact, Dr. G.S. Khush had, Aklesh, if you remember, in one of the monitoring committee meetings, he had mentioned that every time he sleeps, he thinks of a designer crop. When he gets up, he thinks of a designer crop. And when he did really had that super rice variety in which he had put 30 genes, all novel traits, less water consuming, abiotic, biotic resistance, everything. He said that is what he's dreaming, something like a designer crop. Agriculture biotechnology is extremely important today. I think biotechnology department has to really, really go in a very big way in the agriculture area if we really want to look at all those figures which Dr. Bhatia showed yesterday, the malnutrition, the hunger in the country. Let's not even think of the world, let's think of the country first. The largest number of malnourished children and women in this country, more than South Africa, more than Bangladesh, more than other countries. We have to really tackle this problem very, very seriously. What did Norman Borlaug say? Again, why I want to repeat this very famous quote of his is, it's only because we are all discussing all the time, and I'm not going to go into that discussion of GM crops. But look at what he has said. Genetic modification of crops is not some kind of witchcraft. Rather, it is the progressive harnessing of the forces of the nature to benefit of the feeding the human race. The genetic engineering of plants at the molecular level is just another step in humankind's deepening scientific journey into living genomes. That was what Norman Borlaug said. And this is you can see the GM globally, 181.5 million hectares under GM crops, 90% of countries, 90% of this is grown in just the 5 countries. And you can see that. Medical biotechnology, again, as I have said, that has to give us overwhelming impact. What has happened, what Crick had said at that time when he had unraveled the DNA structure. And Harold Varmus, he had come to India, and when he was asked, I had taken him to meet the Honorable Prime Minister at that time, and his Prime Minister asked him, what is the most serious problem the country is facing when it comes to medical and health area? And he said immediately, epidemiology, the correct assessment of the disease burden. Unless we have that, we cannot go ahead and develop a diagnostic or a therapeutic or a vaccine. That was what he had said. And then again, he talked about malnutrition and poor water supply. These are two very critical areas. Water is, of course, connected always with malnutrition. And he, of course, he goes on to say science has an essential role and all that. But what is most important is that we want investment in science research. That's the most critical point. There is no way, if you don't invest in scientific research today, next 20 years, we'll be, after 20 years, we would know what we have missed and what we have lost. So investment in science is most critical in the present context. Environmental biotechnology, I'm not going to go into the details of these areas, but again, why I want to mention is that DBT was very closely involved. And I'm very happy to see Dr. C.R. Babu has come here. And Vijay, he did a wonderful experiment in the mountain regions of Masuri Hills. It was the lime quarry, and the whole area was completely devastated. And there was just no vegetation. And he took a project from the DBT and did microbial consortia and combination of that with selected species of plants. In 3 years, the whole area was vegetated. And that was a live experiment which Dr. Babu had done with the help of DBT. So why I want to say is bioremediation today all over the world has become a money spinner. It has become such an important technology in biotechnology that everybody now wants to go for bioremediation, partly because of the pollution problems. And these are all the things which DBT had developed. Oil zapper technology, I want to also mention here. Terry's development, very important. And this was for the bioremediation of the crude oils. This was again transferred to the field, and the ONGC and many oil fields, Bombay High, etc., use this technology. Biofuels, I know this is a very recent approach of DBT, and I congratulate Vijay, you and Renu both. I believe you both of you have started a very good program on biofuels, and DBT has prepared a sort of a vision document also in this area. And bioenergy will be a priority, I believe, now in the coming years. And the DBT has a roadmap 2020, which I have seen, and it is now also available on your website. I think in this particular program, my suggestion is that we must involve lots of universities, researchers from various institutions and industry. This has to be a multi-institutional, but not just multi-institutional from the research laboratories, but also from the university system. Bioenergy will be, in the next few years, a most critical area which we have to tackle. Bioinformatics, I have already talked of, so I'll move fast. Capacity building. 72 departments of biotechnology, and we have to enlarge this. We have to really join, and I'll come to this point in a moment. Biotechnology as a business of the future, we have seen it yesterday. Some figures were given for for 2020 it was advanced, and I think we should aim at that biotechnology really becomes a real business. And these are some of the figures which were given to me by REC. And I can see that there is a positive increase, a sustained increase in the growth of bioindustry in the country. And some people have said that this will become the single largest sector in the years to come for the employment of the skilled human resource. That is what they say about biotech industry. And this, of course, the existing three-tier biosafety system which exists, but we are still waiting for the biotechnology regulatory authority to come up. Maybe that would facilitate and answer many queries which the industry is having today. This was one glimpse of biotechnology, new areas, and all the areas which we were tackling at that time. But I'm sure this has to be changed now in the light of what new areas DBT has taken up, particularly the focus on the stem cell research. This was the map of India we used to show, and I have tried to add many other things also to this. This only shows here that there is no regional imbalance. DBT was going through entire country to see that biotechnology infrastructure. We went to Northeast, Shillong, Professor Pramod Tandon, to establish a tissue culture laboratory. So each and every important educational or research institution of the country should have a seat of biotechnology research soon. I have just a few suggestions, and I'm coming to the end of my talk now. Sustaining with highest productivity and accountability, that's the most important thing. Productivity, when I say in terms of the new products, new processes, new technologies. Accountability is very important. We have been very liberal. We have been very gracious in funding large projects to various people. And now we need accountability for that. What is the outcome of all those funding we have made? What have they achieved in 10, 15 years, and now 30 years? Then, new research industry partnership, the PPP, which has become very important, and BIREC is going to play a very important role. We have a very robust regulatory structure, but we urgently need to strengthen it more. As I said, industry is still having lots of query. Unless we will go ahead with a more strong and more diversified regulatory structure, it will not be possible. Then nurturing and mentoring the young talent. I think that's the key to the whole thing what I have talked of. We have to nurture the young people who have taken up biology now as a career, who are progressing very well, who are using DBT money, who are using DBT projects. We must mentor them, nurture them. Let's not get them lost in the entire, you know, big sea. We should see that they come and do some work for the DBT. We must tap these young resources whom we have supported over the years. Before creating new institutions, that's my advice, we must see that the existing ones are giving the best performance. There's just no new need to start a new institute because we have a very good infrastructure now in the country, unless it is absolutely critical. For example, yesterday, Vijay, you mentioned about marine biotechnology. Yes, it's a very important area. Although NIO, CSM, CRI, Bhavnagar, they are doing some work, Goa University, but we certainly need a more focused center of excellence for that. That's an important area. But before going for the new institutions, we must see that the existing ones are giving their best performance. And in this connection, I'm sure all of us remember the statement PM made in the Science Congress, science audit. So from the institutions now, we must see what is the science audit. What is the performance? How much money was given? Large projects, what is the infrastructure? And how many scientists are using that infrastructure? Many a times it has happened that huge infrastructure has been built, very big building. But what is happening, you'll see in the verandas, cockroaches all over. Because there's no one to use those buildings. There's just no equipment there. There's no money to maintain such buildings. What are we going to do with that? It is better that we invest that money in research, in consumables, rather than going for huge buildings. Very compact buildings can work very well, like we have all our institutions. So before going for a new infrastructure, I think at this time it is important. We should always have funds for any bright and emerging areas that we have always done in the DBT, that has been DBT culture. We go out of the way if somebody comes to us with a bright idea that this is what we want to do, and we feel that that has the potential. International collaborations basically have been very well, and in the last few years I noticed that there are several more international collaborations which have come up, but these have to help us in the skill development and improvement. That is one of the crux. Immediately nobody is giving us the technology, or they won't give us a new product immediately. All that will cost a lot of money. But skill improvement and skill development can become the major stay of the international collaboration. Bioinstrumentation, we have the medical devices, we have a biodesign center which has done extremely well. I believe it has been quoted so many places, so many patents, etc. Then what is the last point, and that is the we must contribute to the national missions. 5 or 6 missions of the DBT: multi-institutional, multi-agency, interdisciplinary, networking and teaming, and time-bound, mission-oriented, targets fixed, well-defined, and appropriate implementation and monitoring. It's very easy to formulate a project, but we have to look at its implementation. Sometimes after the sanction of the project, it takes 6 years to 1 month. Why? We must start implementation even before the sanction letter has reached you. If you are really genuinely interested in the program. And I just want to illustrate just 5 or 6 missions which are related to the national missions. One is a skill development, and DBT has done exceedingly well. We must continue to do that, and we should make it as a mission program. We must fix a number. So many life scientists, biotechnologists in different areas we are going to train in the next 2 to 3 years. It can be a short-term mission for 3 years, and let us see how we contribute to the skill development. It has to be a mission, and certainly we have to focus on women. Unless we bring them into the mainstream, particularly in the rural areas, I think the things will not work well. Swasth Bharat. We must join hands with ICR and ICMR. This is the international year for pulses. Can we take a mission And when we take a mission, my suggestion would be that we make one of our autonomous institution as the leader, identify one. For example, for the pulses program, a multi-institutional mission mode program on genomics of pulses, NIPGR can be the lead agency, and a number of ICR institutions can join. This is so important for the nutritional value and for the country's need. I think we DBT can initiate a mission mode program with NIPGR and many ICR agencies as the one of the mission. That will come under the Swasth Bharat. And of course, all the pharmaceutical work and all the pharma and medical biotechnology, that will continue to contribute. But can we just think of, let us say, 4 diagnostic kits we will release. And Vijay, I still remember South Campus, Delhi University, a very small lab of Vijay Chaudhary, when we got that AIDS diagnostic kit. And that kit is now being exported. Not only used in India, but also exported. And that was just a small lab in the university. We are so proud of that, that was the first kit we released on a technology day, which was developed in a university system, not in a research laboratory. Diagnostics, as I said, bioprospecting or bioresources, we should not forget this program. This was started with a great enthusiasm in the collaboration with Department of Space. We used their remote sensing technology. We produced some beautiful maps and data for the whole country for the bioresources. I think this is very important program. Drug development, I think, already is a part of the translational research program, and plant-based therapeutics. Clean energy, biofuels, already we have started, but I want these as missions, a mission on the clean energy, which will include all the question of biofuels, storage devices, cultivation on large scale. We have the tissue culture technology already. Yesterday, Dr. Bhatia showed us 500 units in the country, and the capacity is that 500. We are still not producing to the maximum capacity. Swachh Bharat, bioremediation, waste disposal. Both these are very important. And we have initially started a small program on bioremediation. I think we can take it up. There are large chunks of soil in the country which are not fertile, which are not being used for purposes. Can we do bioremediation there? Startups. Now this is the latest, and I'm sure with the help of BIRAC, Biodesign Center, and Biotechnology Parks, the entrepreneurship development can become a mission. Just one or two startups we can start and see, take them from the start to the end, to the logical conclusion. That's what I look at as a mission program. So these 5 or 6 missions, they will all contribute to the national missions which have been announced by the Honorable Prime Minister. And Vijay, you also wrote in your letter, that's the reason I have put up this, because you mentioned all this, that DBT is interested in taking up these areas in the future years. So what's our aim? Launch these missions and work for clean, healthy, happy, prosperous nation. Biotechnology for food and nutrition, health, environment, employment, livelihood security. And it must reach the poorest of the poor. Let's look at this. This is just for the younger people. Einstein's, we never forget this quote, concern for man, his fate must always be chief interest of all the technical efforts. And do not forget the face of the poor. And not only he said, but look at what Gandhiji said, recall the face of the poorest and weakest man you have seen and ask yourself if this step you contemplate is going to be any use to him. My best wishes for a very successful and productive years and very, very happy 30 years. And my heartiest congratulations to Professor Vijay Raghavan, to Dr. Renu Sarup, to all the other advisors of the DBT officials, and the entire scientific community of biology for celebrating these 30 years. Heartiest congratulations, Vijay, to you and to your team.
Thank you, ma'am, for taking us back in time, illustrating different programs initiated, and for your valuable suggestions.